It's 12 o'clock on a Wednesday and this is the Wizard Product Review. I'm Dave.
And I'm Sean.
And on this week's show, first of all, we've got quite an array of stuff. The results of the competition to win the hydrostatic shot glass from the hydrostatic glass range by propdog.co.uk that was featured on the last show. And first up this week, it's put out by card-shark.de. I'm never sure what it actually is, their extension. It's put out by a card shark. It's David Gonzalez's Destiny deck. Let's read a few of these quotes on the back here, Sean. When David showed me his Destiny deck at FISM in Rimini, I said, "You should not show it to me. You should do this in the competition. Amazing possibilities, Pitt Hartling. This deck has to be in my the repertoire of any magician who wants to achieve real impossibility." Danny DeOrtiz.
Mm.
They're not bad quotes, these,
well,
are they?
Danny DeOrtiz's mentor, Juan Tamariz, as well.
Yeah.
Well,
David's idea is amazing. With deep love and effect and effort, he has managed to maximise the possibilities of this deck and develop many strong effects for it. So basically, what you get with the Destiny deck is a gimmick deck.
It's a great gimmick deck.
Well, let's talk about some of the routines that you can do with it. There are multiple routines, one of which, we can't say for sure, but one of which may have been featured by a very well-known television magician.
A competition-winning one?
Maybe an AGT award-winning magician?
An AGT award-winning magician?
It's either Matt Franco or Shin Lim. Shin Lim, and this is the first time we've had to congratulate Shin.
And who may not have done an appearance on the Jimmy Kimmel Show.
Yeah, so you could have a look at that footage there, and it's a possibility that maybe the Destiny deck was in use there during this fantastic performance.
But in a nutshell, it very basically allows the spectator to very freely choose a playing card. Even if they shuffle the deck first, they can shuffle the cards first, they can very freely shuffle, choose a card, the card can go back in the pack, the cards can be freely shuffled again, and then in the spectator's hands, whilst the spectators are cuffed and shuffling cards in whatever order they like, it allows you to be in a situation where their chosen card is then at the top of the pack. After they've shuffled and mixed them and everything. Now, that is the most basic of forms of the routine. I suggest
Sean, let's do the basic form. I've left a prediction card there.
All these cards
are all different. Every single one of the cards. Mm. They are definitely all different. I could even spread these in front of Sean right now. These are the large index. You could see that they are all different. Every single card in the deck. Sean, I'm going to get you to do this. You're going to mix the order of these cards.
Yeah.
I want you to take some off the top, put them on the bottom, then put some down.
Okay.
Right? And just repeat that process. So some off the top, some on the bottom, and then put them down into a pile.
Some on the table, some off the top.
That's it. Put them down. Just keep them in one pile.
Some on the table, some off the top, some on the table. Then do I stop anywhere?
Yeah, just keep going until the end.
Some on the top. Table.
So that's completely random, right?
That is random.
That is as literally as random as you get. And you stopped at this card.
I did.
This is completely random. Look, I've got a king of clubs there.
Yes,
and from another deck, I put on the table, before we even started, another card. What's that card?
And that card.
It's
another king of clubs. The prediction matches. Now, that is it in its most crudest and basic of forms, isn't it?
Yeah.
And performed incredibly well.
if
you watch that video we were talking about, you'll get an idea of the level
Sean,
of the
give me a number feat. Between 10 and 20.
7.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 6. This is the 7th card.
And it really is.
It's the King of Clubs.
And what's great about it, the spectators can handle the cards. The spectators can shuffle the cards. They can cut the cards. They can do all sorts of manner of things. And again, the level of tricks that can be done, once you get into the psychology and the little bits behind all the different things you can do, you can do so much with this trick. Not just like pick a card, find it, name a number, where it is. You can do so many different things with it, can't you?
The main effect, I guess, is called the Destiny Routine by David on the downloads. There's about 6 different routines.
Yeah.
The main Destiny Routine is, he says to this spectator, it's your destiny to pick this certain card. I think it's the Queen of Hearts in their example. And she touches literally any card, and it's that card, the Queen of Hearts in that example, and he turns the cards over, and very fairly you can see that the cards are in new deck order.
Absolutely.
And she has touched exactly the right card in that position. It doesn't make any sense. And then he puts definitely the Queen of Hearts to one side, as well as all the other hearts, gets her to touch any other card in the deck, and that card ends up being the Queen of Hearts once again in exactly the right position, and all the hearts that were put to one side, the Queen's not there, and he keeps stressing that this is their destiny. But amazingly, you can perform card at any number. You can force a card incredibly freely and have a prediction any way you liked on Instagram or Facebook or anything like that. It's probably the best force of any card out there.
Absolutely.
But just calling it the best way to force a card does limit your imagination, because as David has proved and Sean's just said, there are so many routines you can do with this. Like, you've already said you're going to use this, Sean.
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, I've got some filming that I'm going to be doing in about 7 or 8 months' time, and that's
it's a video
I've got a video with this. Like, I've got a thing straight away for it. So it's really great.
It's easily a whole routine. And I think that's the good thing about it. Each one of the routines submitted by David with the Destiny Deck downloadable instructions that are very well laid out on the Card Shark website, you can kind of mastered like 5 or 6 different routines.
Very and easily.
If you watch the Shin Lim performance, it's not just one trick, it's one thing that leads on to another and gets multiple reactions with the same deck.
Now, there's things with lots of different ways of performing card tricks. So there's ways of, oh, isn't the magician skillful?
Yeah.
Or he's reading my mind. But in some ways, the spectators might go, oh, that's very clever, but they might think, oh, it's obviously mathematics, or it's just sleight of hand. It allows you to do things that transcend, that make it much more impossible than that. For example, there's a dream card effect on there, isn't there?
Oh, God, that's
which is so simple, but there's literally, a spectator will have no way where to go with anything. So, and it makes a really nice display of the table as well. Anyway, so you put a card on the table beforehand, face down, and you then have the spectators, one spectator number one shuffles and cuts the card, and they end up looking at one
just
playing
looking
card.
Just looking at it, not showing anybody
then,
else.
And then that playing card that they looked at then gets placed down on the table just here, making sort of, that shape. And then spectator number two does the same, shuffles, cuts, gets to a card, they look at their card, and the card that they chose is then sat down on the table like this, and then then the cards are spread.
Both people then say the card.
They say the card at the same time, 1, 2, 3,
King of Clubs.
The two cards that they name, they both believe are the King of Clubs, are then turned over, and they're no longer the King of Clubs, which is quite
just
a cool moment.
Cards, yeah.
But there's been this card that's been on the table the whole time, and that has been the King of Clubs. Now, I know there are ways of achieving this using sleight of hand, but they are using sleight of hand. What this allows you to do is, without any moves or anything dirty, in the hands of spectators, or I'd say 90% of it in the hands of spectators, yeah, I like to do that routine, and there's nowhere for them to go.
It's very good. It's on Phoenix back cards. It's a completely gimmick deck. You're not going to be able to use this deck for any other routines.
No.
But I'm guessing if you're doing a formal close-up show or a video or a TV spot or something like that, you're easily going to be able to use this as the routine that you do.
Or if you're in the middle of a close-up set, if you were doing sponge balls, ropes, and then a card trick, this could be the card trick.
It is a brilliant effect. The only downside I've got, and it is a real downside, I think it's too much money.
Yeah, you said that. It's
it's $79. I know it's a brilliant effect. I know it's been sold out worldwide. I know a lot goes into this. Not $79, 79 euros.
Euros.
I will check that price and I'll correct myself.
It's the same thing anyway, euros,
but it's,
dollars.
But it's about, it will be soon. It's not a cheap effect, so you need to think very carefully about whether this effect suits you, if you're doing it for a TV appearance or a video that's going to end up getting thousands of views for a client of yours. It's not a problem. But it is a deck of cards. You're going to have to take very good care of it. You can't get it wet. You can't be doing this on grubby restaurant tables. You need it in a formal close-up setting so you can ensure that it's going to be kept pristine all the time. That's the only reason I'm marking it down, because of the price. I do think if this was like 30 euros or 35 euros, I'd be saying it's one of the best effects to come out, but it's double that price, and that does bother me.
Absolutely, it's worth it for me for one video, and that's what it'll get used for. I think if this was going to go in my working repertoire and I wanted to make this a feature of my set, knowing that I'd probably have to buy a new pack once every 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Maximum, probably if I had 5 gigs in a week, that's going to be dead by the end of the week.
Yeah.
Right, so do I really want to be spending 80 quid a week on a pack of cards? I don't, unfortunately, but I am going to buy one for a video next year, so I do have a use for it.
It's available from Cardshark, card-shark.de, was it? I always forget their extension.
DE.
You can see all the performances online. Go and visit the website. It's a great deck. It's a first-class gimmick. There is a lot of work that goes into it. I don't mean any disrespect by complaining about the price. I just think it's a lot of money for a custom deck. However, I'm still giving it 95%.
Yeah, as I said, I'm definitely doing it on a video, so I can't say anything less than 90%. I think it's incredibly good. I'm going to go 1% higher than David, 96% from me.
Yeah, available from Card Shark. It's brilliant, the Destiny deck.
Now, every now and again, something new comes to Magic that's never been done before.
Yeah, like and the Destiny.
Like the Destiny deck, like some of these smoke gimmicks that come out.
Yeah.
And today, we bring to you the Crash Joker 2.0.
Yeah, I don't even remember the first one that came out, if I'm honest, from your favourite Murphy's Magic dealer, this one.
So there's been an update, yeah.
So, I don't actually remember the first one, from Sonny Boone Magic. And what's the effect, Sean?
The effect is, you explain that, I don't know, the pattern that you might use might be that the Joker on the back of the playing card.
Well, he has some pattern, doesn't he? Yeah. He suggests it.
He's drunk?
Patter's causing him problems. The Jokers are always causing him problems.
So really naughty Jokers, basically. Yeah. And
the Joker, you keep it separate by sticking it inside the cellophane of the outside of the card box. That's a reasonable thing.
Anyway, you take the Joker out, and you want you just to discover why it's causing you problems, and you go, you flap the card like that, and the bicycle that the Joker's riding turns into real life, and it falls off the card.
A truly shocking moment.
It is a shocking moment, that's right. And then you turn the card over, and the Joker is now in a heap sort of on the floor because he's fallen off the bicycle. It's all right. This isn't a feature effect. At best, what this is when you're having a spectator, say, sign a card, you go over to your card case and go, oh, look, whilst that's happening, you'll notice the Jokers aren't even in the pack. I'll keep them over here in the box. That's because they're very naughty Jokers.
Yeah.
And they cause lots of trouble. I'll show you what I mean. And by the time you've got the bicycle off the card and you've done that bit, hopefully the card will have been signed. I don't think it's a feature trick. It's not a trick that you're going to go, oh, look, I've got something amazing
what's
to show
clever, you. What's clever is the principle. And other people, I know Michael Chatelain and other people have messed around with this principle of having a card stuck under the cellophane. Offset was a brilliant effect.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you get this bicycle with it and all the gimmicks that you need to basically make that Joker look absolutely normal. You can fairly take it out from under the cellophane as long as you can justify it being there. We both said, didn't we? We wouldn't rely on the holdout principle, which is supplied with some extra gimmickry.
Because without giving anything away, you've got to bring this into play that's going to appear somehow.
And we just said we put the card box in our pocket.
All right, when I was like,
then come out ready to do the trick.
If I was doing that signed card bit when I went to get the pen out of my pocket to give to the person, that's when I'd bring that into play.
Yeah, I think from a layman's perspective, I think when magicians see the difference between the cards and they see the one with the Joker on the bicycle and then they see the one with the Joker crashed, I think it's more of a funny image to magicians because we're used to seeing that Joker so much that we know what it looks like when it looks different.
I mean,
I don't know if it would register as strong with
I don't think it would. And I'll probably give you an example of last week's Wizard product review. Yeah. I changed my jacket 3 times during the show. Nobody noticed. No. And it's the same thing. I have a jacket change during my show for a secret reason, and nobody notices that my jacket changes 3/4 of the way through the show. Yeah. And this is the... it's only a subtle change, but it still changes.
Well,
I'll tell you what I did like is
I like the principle. I like the fact that you can cleanly show that Joker, and it looks so fair to see that Joker under the cellophane, and it looks very clean how you take it out. I'm actually not that fussed about the effect that you get with all this hassle of going to this trouble of gaffing your card box over a 10-minute period to just make this little wooden bicycle appear. Like, you know, if you've got big dreams and you want to win AGT like Shin Lim, you're not going to get it by producing a little wooden bicycle out of a car. Just a moment.
Dave, that's a very, very good point as well, because magic is becoming more and more popular at the minute.
Yeah.
And what that means is the people that you're performing it to, whether it's at TGI Fridays or it's a high-end corporate event, they're now exposed to people like Shin Lim.
They see it.
And so if they've seen Shin Lim make 300 playing cards levitate and a prediction and all this stuff happening, and then you go up to their tables in between their burger and their ice cream and go, oh, I've got a bicycle, then maybe they're going to view you in a certain way. Yeah, that may be humouring you.
Yeah.
Rather than being blown away by you. So I think now, because magic's so televised, you do have to up your game a little bit, and I don't think that's going to help you do it.
Well, it is a question, you know, we're going to have how much are you going to give this?
Well, look, it does work. The guy has put a lot of thought into it. I'm not going to do it. Probably 59%.
Yeah, I was going to give it 35%.
Yeah.
But here's a question for this week. Maybe we had some great comments on last week's show, and we'll announce the winner in a moment. Maybe we could get people to comment on this week's show. What tricks are magicians doing in close-up conditions that are just not good enough anymore? What about that?
Yes.
Comment about a trick that we know magicians do, whatever you might think it, and it's just not good enough.
Yeah, what trick would you, what are you going to send to 101? But people have to be doing it. It can't be something that's not been done since the Dark Ages. Yeah. What tricks
people
are you going to banish?
People are doing out now that are a little bit cheesy and a little, but magicians need a wake-up call and need to actually stop doing these tricks.
I will put ding dong in that bin.
Yeah.
I'll put it out there, that's what I'm going to say. What are you going to put in the bin?
Oh, I don't know. I'd have to really think about it. I think anything that looks like a mathematical card trick, like a principle, like give me 3 cards, which 3 cards have got it on, or
and also, you know, I think that a lot as well. I think you put something on your Facebook recently, and it's a trick that I've always steered away from, that the magicians have used, because I think the spectators think it's mathematical and not magic, to the point where it's now mainstream enough that Sandy Toksvig went out and did it on QI.
Yeah.
A few days ago, and you got to go. And I think that should be a wake up call to magicians as well. You know what else out there? You tell us.
Put
what
a
you
comment.
Think.
You could win. Last week we had a lot of comments over various. We had 16 shares on our video. Thank you so much if you took the trouble to share the Wizard product review into a magic group and you started your own discussion. We went round. We looked at all those shares. We wrote down everybody. We chose somebody at the random. I think he put a comment about he's changed the words from hug and kill to hug and kiss.
Yeah.
And the winner was Steve Legg. So Steve, get in touch with the show. I've already checked. We're already friends on Facebook. So send me a message, Steve, and you will get the hydrostatic glass, which was donated very kindly by propdog.co.uk. So leave us a comment and you could win this week's prize, which is the...
No, it's not.
Actually this one that is coming up for review very, very shortly.
Giving that away as a prize.
Kyle Purnell's Elimination Experiment, of which the review is coming up next. Available from your favourite Murphy's Magic dealer, and Cosmo Magic have produced this, Kyle Purnell's Elimination Experiment. So it's a packet card trick.
It is a packet card trick.
Slightly better than
that. Oh, is it? Now, before we go any further, I will say, as a kid, we used to have things called CDs. that he used to go to the shop. And what would happen on the CD, there'd either be like a hidden track on it or something. Yeah. Or maybe you knew it was on there, you'd wait like an extra 20 minutes and the hidden track could come on. And sometimes it was a bit naff and sometimes it was amazing. It was better than the singer in the first place. You'd think, why didn't you release that? Because they need to be number one, but you're not, you're number 10. And I think this is very similar to that, because this is a very, very good trick.
You like the bonus trick.
But the bonus trick's incredible.
Elimination Experiment. There is a bonus trick called Calculator Cards, but the Elimination Experiment, for which you get all the custom printed cards, you do have to do some custom writing on the cards.
Right, you've got to write like four words.
You've got the card. I think what I like about this, it's instantly engaging when you go up to spectators, and the routine is basically you show the traditional sort of ESP cards, the rhyme cards, the circle, the cross, the wavy lines, the square, and the star. And they choose one of the cards to eliminate.
Yes, they
do. That's right. Very fairly, you eliminate that card and you put them put that card into your pocket. And then you say, I knew that you would eliminate that card.
Yep.
Because then, for the first time, you turn over those cards and it says on the back, you will eliminate, in the case of the performance, the wavy lines.
Or whatever, and it really is a free choice. It's not the wavy lines.
Completely free choice. But then what's really cool is you turn those cards over and you really did eliminate all the other cards, because all the cards are completely blank.
There's no other cards there.
So you get a prediction and you also get this very strong moment of magic.
Well, I was going to say, I don't think that the description there isn't doing any justice. This is a really strong...
I tried my best, Kyle.
No, it is. Yeah, it's a really strong piece of magic. We were watching this. We were both really, really impressed. Because it's not just something... You know, sometimes you get an impression that some guy's just, oh, we want to bring a trick out so I can get $1,000 or whatever, right? This is something that he's actually put a lot of work into. And he's thought of everything. And I was really impressed by this.
Yeah, you're going to have... it's not basic sleight of hand, it's not high level sleight of hand, but it's
intermediate.
Intermediate is a very good phrase for it, an intermediate level of sleight of hand. There is a move on this that I have never done as a professional magician, that BS move.
It's not a BS move, it's one of the greatest moves in magic.
Yeah, I know, but I've never used it, and for anybody that's got this effect and, you know, rhymes with riddle and initials BS, I've never used this move, and I would have to learn it. So that proves that it's at least intermediate level, intermediate to advanced, I would say, at my level as sleight of hand magician.
Yeah.
But it's easily within the grasp of somebody with a little bit of practice. The cards you get with it, the custom printer, they seem a bit more rigid than normal bicycle cards.
But I think
cards.
That's because when we buy bicycle cards, we buy them from Costco and they're at the end of a run.
Yeah, probably.
And I think maybe if the first run of 10,000 are always a little bit
But they're very
nicer.
Good quality
yeah,
cards.
Very, very
You've
good.
Got to write the prediction on the back yourself to... personalise that prediction to your own handwriting. That's the only work you need to do, and you need to put in that work with that intermediate sleight of hand. What I do like about it is once you've established yourself, once you've introduced yourself, I do think it's engaging. I think they're interesting props. They're not just cards. He's never done this before. I don't know what he's doing. He's resting his head on the table and hanging over the top. It's interesting. Right, so you're looking at least learn that one. That's a better trick. So, it's instantly engaging and you get two very strong moments.
You do.
First of all, you predict their thoughts and then you get the kicker ending, which is the revelation of the blank cards. But you really liked
the
effect known as calculator
the
cards.
The calculator cards.
Can you talk about it?
It's got a lot of stages to it, and I'm just trying to remember now. It's a similar sort of packety type trick thing, isn't it?
Yeah.
And what happens is they randomly choose a number to start with.
You're not selling it to me.
Seriously, there's a prediction. So you name something, which is, it doesn't even say on the back. What's the first, it's the suit, isn't it? They name the suit of the card.
Pause the video.
So, we've watched it again.
There's a lot to remember,
but I think they would agree with me, is one heck of a routine.
It's like
loads
of phenomena. Right, I'm going to try and go through it. Help me if I get it wrong. First of all, they stop anywhere they like and two cards are removed
from
the deck.
In a full pack of cards this time.
Full pack of cards. Two cards are removed, two random cards.
Yeah.
And then he takes out a little wallet and he says, these are calculator cards. He takes the cards out and they're calculator cards and he shows that they're just normal cards.
Yeah, there's like four or five of them.
And they've got numbers on the back. And even though that guy stopped at one card, which is in this example, a nine, the numbers on the back of these four cards, the numbers added up add up to nine.
Yes, they do.
Right, but then he turns them over, and the numbers on the other side also add up to nine.
The numbers on the face,
and that happened right, because he presses the equals button on those cards.
Yeah, that's right.
And then the other lady picks up the other card, and the lady.
Because they've got to spell the letter nine as well, because then he turns them over again, and the numbers have changed to letters, and then it spells N-I-N-E, or whatever the number is.
Now it goes to the lady.
And then the lady picks up the second card.
Second card, and she's asked to multiply the value of that card by the nine. And nobody knows what this is, but she's just thinking of it. And then he asks her to press the equals button. And he says, oh, you didn't press equals, that's multiply. You've messed it up, and all the cards multiply. So where he had a few cards, suddenly he's got lots of cards.
Yeah, four or five cards, now he's got nine or ten cards in his hand.
And he adds up all the values, and all the values.
Well, first of all, she says, what number are you thinking of? She says, I'm thinking of number 18. And then he says, let's add up all the numbers in your hand. And they add up to number 18 again. But that's not it, Dave, is it?
That's not it, because he turns the cards over, and he spells out on the back with the numbers and letters, it spells out perfectly the number 18.
What's great about this is you are beating them up with magic, like you say. You are every part of this trick would be a logical place for the trick to end from the spectator's point of view. And what's great about tricks like that, you do the first bit and the cards on the numbers on the back add up. That could, if you played, I'm not saying you play that first bit to an applause, but that's your first, like, wow.
Maybe I'll be writing a comment about that on Facebook if he did, so you should give up tricks like that.
Yeah, and then it's not just that, but it's this. And no, wait, there's this. There's more. And you're just taking it. You're just knocking them out.
Thank you very much. Good night, Pyros.
Sean Heydon, bam, you're gone.
So basically, you really... I like the elimination experiment more. You like the calculator cards more. The calculator cards is straight out of Carl's formal close-up show. We like both effects. They're not closers. Well, you might close on the calculator cards. They're not closers, but the elimination experiment is definitely a great opener. Instantly engaging for the spectator. Two very strong moments of magic and or a prediction, however you want to play it. I liked it, 92%.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to do something off there. 94% from me. What's great about it is it's long, magical. There's some interesting presentation, especially with the second routine. And there's nothing patronising to the audience. Mm. It all looks like you've thought about it a lot. I'm really impressed with it.
Yeah, I get what you're saying there. Elimination Experiment by Carl Purnell, produced by Cosmo Magic, available from your favourite Murphy's Magic dealer. Finally this week, from Theory11.com, exclusively available from them, it's the Zanman book test. Now, we've got two books here. It comes in two different versions. They both do pretty much the same thing. So you could either buy one book to do the majority of the routine, or combine in a very clever version of the Hoy principle. You could use both books, purchasing both of them for $34.95 plus
each.
Shipping each. But we can dem it, can't we?
We can do it.
Because it uses principles that we have played around with before, we performed before, but there's very unique things to it as well, and we'll try and go into those very shortly. So first of all, I want to stress that this book can be examined. That is one good thing. So I know Larry Becker, I'm trying to flash back to when I first performed it. But this principle has been used before, hasn't it?
Yeah, I'm
but with that principle, you can't look at both sides of the page, and you can't absolutely make sure that the pages are completely different.
That's correct.
These pages are completely different, and there's nothing. I'm trying to flash back to like my youth when I used to do that, you know. But it's kind of similar, but it's not the same. It's really not the same. But I'm going to flick through, Sean. You say stop where you like. I'm going to flick through quite slow. That's not so you say stop in the first part of the book. When you say stop, I stop at the exact page that you want to stop.
Okay.
So I'll go through pretty slowly.
Stop.
Are you happy there?
Yeah.
Look at the first word on the page while I'm looking away. Now I'm
going to
close
it.
Up the book, take the book back from me so I can't see it. Hide the book if you like. I'm turning back around. Is that fair?
That is about as fair as it gets.
Think about your words.
I'm thinking.
Sean, look at me. And what I want you to do, think about a letter in the middle of the word. There's a U. You just thought of a U.
I did think of a U.
And an O. You skip from the O to the U.
That's exactly what
think
I do.
Think of the first letter.
I'm thinking of it.
It's an F, isn't it? Is it the word found?
It is the word found.
And there we go. That's the first thing you could do with that book. So, and genuinely, you know, people could look through this book and they could make sure that it's absolutely all different. Another thing you could do with it is to get people to say stop.
And stop.
Just there?
Yeah.
Do you want this page or do you want this page, Sean?
I will go on to this page just here, please.
This page, yeah. Just here.
Yeah.
Can you find on that page a big interesting word on this page? Can you see a big interesting word?
Yeah, I've got one.
Okay, and just like we did before, what I want you to do is think about the letters in that word. See the whole word in your mind, see it letter by letter.
Yeah.
Rather than me trying to get the whole word, this is the easiest way for me to do it.
Yeah.
There's an A in that word, isn't there?
There is an A in the word.
Okay. There's an L in the word.
There is an L in the word.
I'll be honest, I've never got this far before. There's a P in the word, isn't there?
There is a P in the word.
Is the word you're thinking of? And I'll just check, there were other big words on the page.
You're thinking of the word policeman? It was policeman.
Fantastic. And if you've got both books just like this, just say stop anywhere you like,
stop.
Sean. This is page 106.
Okay.
Okay. 106, turn to 106 in your book and look at the first word on your page. On page 106.
Okay.
Keep it up towards yourself.
Yeah.
Is the word you're thinking of lower?
It is lower.
Dun dun dun.
Dun, 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 dun.
So that gave you kind of like a run through of all the things you can do with these two books. The last bit using a very clever version of the Hoy principle, but better than that, because it's very deceptive. There's nothing to find. These books aren't the same book, are they?
They're different books. If there is
you
a
did
we-
make a point.
Yeah.
Go on.
If there is a weakness, I would say I think you made. We both made it at the same time, actually. But. If I was going to do this, I think these books do look very similar.
Yeah.
So if I was going to do them together, it would have been nice, for example,
but
for this to be a big square yellow one and this be a little black one or something. But I think, to be fair, they're even a similar colour scheme, aren't they? Yeah, they've used the same colours. I think it will fly by spectators. Would it be that important to me if I was going to do the routine to have the thing where I was using one number in one book to generate a number in this book? I probably wouldn't anyway.
Yeah.
I'd probably just use.
I'd like just the one book, and you could choose either one of those, whether you use the Sherlock Holmes one or the Great Gatsby.
The big finale, whichever way around you do it, the big finale with this one is when they think of the big word.
Yes.
And you're there on stage with your whiteboard, and you're getting it letter by letter, and then you turn the whiteboard round, and you happen to have got it right. That's your big finish with this. Maybe adding the extra book in, it's good if you need it, but I'd say it's not essential, because I think your big finish is still there just with one book.
Yeah, the weakness is for the big word thing, you're kind of limited. You can't do it with every page in the book, can you? The first part that's very similar to that principle that I was thinking of when I was younger, it goes beyond that. It's very clever, actually. Because you can actually look at both sides of the pages, you can make comparisons, there is nothing the same. In fact, I'd go as far as saying you could read this book and you'd be absolutely fine.
And that's what I have been doing as well. There's nothing that they're going to find. And what's great about the way that, without exposing the method, you never need to see the word.
No.
Do you? You're never actually looking or having the secretly peeking at the spectator's word. You never actually see it, which is really, really clever.
It's very clever. It's been, I've used the Master Key book test in my show before, and it's very, very, very strong. A book test is a strong effect. It will always connect with an audience. If you feel that you can make a routine with a book fit your performance, because it's not the sort of thing you can do walkabout, really, is it?
Well, that's what we're arguing about. Well, we don't argue, we were talking about it before. I would go, this is just a stage magic trick. However, I have seen magicians doing book tests in walkarounds getting incredible reactions. So it's just because I can't do it, it doesn't mean it it doesn't fit me, it doesn't mean it can't be done by people.
I like it, and one of the best things about this, and book tests are notorious for being quite expensive, aren't
yeah.
they? And actually, I'm very impressed with the price. If you want to just use one book, just under $35, I think is very, very
34
fair.
34 books, wow.
Indeed.
And I know, I've seen these, you know, mother of all book tests and things like
$200 that. $200 yeah. or whatever. Yeah. But yeah, very, very impressed with that. It's what it is. Certainly, if you've never dabbled with book tests before and you want to just do the effect like we just demonstrated, we just saw the download
that's
literally
the first time
an
we've
hour
done it.
Ago. And we just first time we've done it, no problem, remembered everything, not a problem at all. There's actually very, very little memory work as well, even with that big word thing at the end and getting the letter by letter.
Because there's a crib.
Yes. Yeah. But the crib's not all of it, is it?
No,
but yeah, it's great. There's very little memory work involved. And yeah, very impressed, but mostly exactly opposite to the Destiny Dex criticism, very impressed with the price. That makes me increase my mark with this. I'm giving it exactly 91%.
Again, what a great show this week. 91% from me as well too.
Available from Theory11.com. It is the Zandman Book Test. That's it this week for the Wizard Product Review. Don't forget to leave us a comment to have your chance of winning the Elimination Experiment. Leave your comment. What tricks are performed by regular close-up magicians that should go into Room 101, should be banned, should be dismissed from the magic performing repertoire forever? That's it, though. This week, now, on the Wizard Product Review. You're going to look at the camera now, because it's kind of the end of the show. That's it this week for the Wizard Product Review. We'll see you in a couple of weeks' time. Thank you for watching. Thank you for sharing. Leave us a comment. Like Steve Legg, you might just win. I'm Dave.
And I'm Sean.
See you next time on the Wizard Product Review.